This video covers the extra material that's in the Cambridge IGCSE Physics course and not the Edexcel course. The other revision videos on my YouTube channel cover the Edexcel course, but you could use this video to top up if you're doing the Cambridge course. So let's take a look at the Cambridge course structure. The syllabus splits it into five topics: general physics, thermal, waves, electricity and magnetism, and atomic physics. The Edexcel videos on my channel are split into the topic structure of Edexcel. Now, the general topic in Cambridge is very similar to forces and motion, but it also includes bits from energy and solids, liquids and gases. The thermal topic is very similar to the energy and the solids, liquids and gases topic. Waves is almost identical. Atomic is almost identical to radioactivity. And electricity and magnetism is similar to these two topics, but there's a fair bit extra for this, as you'll see later in my second video. So let's look at topic one. They give you some things, very simple things about measuring in the Cambridge course. You use a rule to measure distance. You can use a set square sometimes to help you get the straight edge of an object and line it up with a ruler. That would help you be more accurate. You can use a stopwatch or stop clock to measure the time, but don't forget about your reaction time when you press a button on the stopwatch. Your reaction time could be about 0.2 of a second. It might be more or less depending on the circumstances. It can be more accurate and more precise if you measure a large number of oscillations, for example a pendulum swinging back and forth. If you count 10 oscillations and then divide by 10, you'd get a more accurate measurement of the time for one oscillation. You use a measuring cylinder to measure volumes of fluids, and the thinner the measuring cylinder, the more precise it is. You'd get smaller graduations on the scale. When you measure to the liquid, you measure to the bottom of the meniscus. The liquid curves up slightly at the edges, so it's important to make sure your eye is level with the bottom of the meniscus before reading it. If you're measuring a very small distance, it would be more accurate to measure more of the same object and then divide. For example, if you measured the thickness of this ream of paper as being 50 millimeters and it has 500 sheets, the thickness of one sheet can be calculated by dividing by the number of sheets. A micrometer can be used to measure very small distances. You turn the ratchet at the end until the thimble clicks, and that gives you the size of the object. There are two scales, a main scale and the thimble scale. The main scale reads in millimeters with half millimeters on the bottom, and the thimble scale reads in hundredths of a millimeter. So this one reads 5.5 millimeters on the main scale, and then you add on 28 hundredths on the thimble scale. So the final length would be 5.78 millimeters. Things can accelerate at a non-uniform rate or a non-constant rate of acceleration. This velocity time graph shows something is speeding up, but the gradient of this line isn't constant. The gradient is lower here and greater here. So the rate of acceleration increases over this journey. And because the gradient is changing, it's increasing, it could be, for example, a space shuttle taking off. The mass of the space shuttle is very heavy at the beginning because it's laden with fuel. As it burns off the fuel, its acceleration rate increases. The area under the graph is still the distance travelled, which is a bit hard to measure, but you could estimate it if you had smaller squares on your grid. We'd look at an example of using moments. Here, a nail is being removed from some wood by using a claw hammer. The claw hammer pivots about the base here, and the force applied from the person's hand is applied a large distance away. So I've put those in blue. A small distance away, a small perpendicular distance away from the pivot, the force would be applied to the nail. And when you pull on the hammer, the moments must be equal, they will balance. Force times distance in red equals force times distance in blue. That gives capital F, this force, equals force times distance divided by large, this big D, capital D here, which means that the output force is a ratio of the lengths bigger than the input force. This device is a force amplifying machine. To work out whether an object would be stable on a slope, you need to consider where the pivot is. The pivot will be the outside edge of the bottom corner, and you need to know the centre of mass of the vehicle in this case. Now, I've drawn the centre of mass here slightly nearer the bottom than the top, because a lot of the mass of the bus will be at the bottom, although when the bus is full of passengers, the centre of mass will rise slightly. This bus is stable because the centre of mass is slightly to the left of the pivot, and so that will produce a moment turning the bus anti-clockwise so it stays on the slope. This bus will be unstable. The centre of mass is shown again, and it produces a moment that pulls to the right of the pivot. Because the centre of mass is vertically to the right of the pivot, it will try and turn the bus clockwise, so it would topple over. That's the end of the extra material for topic 1, but if you're using my Edexcel revision videos to revise for your Cambridge course, notice that there are also some videos in topic 5 and 4 of the Edexcel course that are covered in topic 1 in the Cambridge course.